morning. Good morning, everyone. Come on, wake up. Okay, good to speak to everyone. My name is Shaili, as they've already introduced me. I'm going to talk to you guys about startups. And the world of startups is a bit like this hall, mostly male-dominated. What one tends to see is that women are beginning to come up, and the good news is that the growth rate of women entrepreneurs in the startup ecosystem is nearly 50%. And I'm delighted to say that when I set up this platform called Shethepeople.tv, the aim actually was to expand India's declining list of women who were choosing to not step into entrepreneurship, not take risks, not engage with failure, not take a chance on successes that they could bring in. And that's why when we kicked it off, it started as something for women entrepreneurs, but then later became something that reached out to every woman who wanted an opportunity to network, to meet more people, to know more inspirational stories of real people, real women. The way I'm going to conduct this conversation, how much time do I have? 30 minutes? Okay, I'm going to actually just use 10 minutes of my time to speak, and then I'm going to get into a Q&A because I am given the impression that a lot of you want to set up your own startups, want to be part of the entrepreneurial journey, and probably have a lot of questions, which I wouldn't be surprised given how much is happening in the startup ecosystem or how much it is falling off the cliff, both ways. Plenty of interesting speakers lined up, I see. A lot of them I've been engaging with off late, so I think you'll get a reality check on where the startup world is really headed. So let me tell you a little bit about my journey. Right, as the introduction said, I've been a journalist for nearly 16 years of my life. Like many of you, I studied economics honors. I'm a Delhi University student. I spent a lot of time understanding why this particular course would really help me out. I had the option of going out there and joining journalism, which is now a legitimate course in DU. But I said, let's actually delve into one subject and see where I can take it. And so I picked up economic honors, and after that I built myself as a journalist. I started with CNBC. A lot of you might actually end up doing business, a platform you'll be familiar with, you will need to be familiar with. And in case any of your companies go across to list, then clearly you'll have to watch out where your stocks are going and how you're talking to investors. Business journalism was at a very nascent stage at that point when I joined it. I think I might have been the third woman to join business journalism back then. And the fascinating part for me was that although we talk about startups in the last 15 months, I have been part of a startup for every third year of my life. And the reason I say that is that when I joined CNBC, it had 18 people. And later it actually built itself to 1,800 people. And that's probably the kind of numbers it does right now in terms of people. We were setting up the culture of business journalism in India. It taught me a lot. One of the things that it really taught me was that you have to be a multitasker. How many of you here are participating in debates? How many of you participate in dance and drama? Yeah? There must be a reason why you all are doing stuff that takes you beyond your academics, right? And that is one thing I encourage each one of you to continue doing. I was talking to one of the coordinators outside this room saying that do not give up any passion you have because you need to get marks. And I'm saying that because I know people who've done that, and I know they are not finding their way in life afterwards. This is a very, 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 very core part of your life, your career, and your ability to get jobs. Last week, we were having a conversation about whether the future of journalism is changing, whether journalism as we know it is dead. One of the things we all talked about, we are no longer looking for skills. People are looking for people who have leadership qualities. Your skills can be acquired on the job. And I would urge every student in this room to think about that. Because the future of jobs, as you know, is getting automated. Which means people who are using creativity will be the people who actually sustain, retain jobs. Those who are doing number crunching, who are doing machine-oriented roles, will be taken over by the computers. And that's why start thinking about the little arts element in your spine. and say, I'm a commerce student, I'm an eco student, I'm a, you know, I'm an English student, or whatever you are, but figure out where does your creativity lie. And that will be the first point of your answer to whether you can or not be an entrepreneur. I think that would be the most important piece that you should keep in mind as you grow as students who want to do something with your own life, take a chance on yourself. The other thing I want to tell you is that failure is an every morning friend. You will meet failure every morning in the mirror. You will meet it on your desktop. You may meet it on your mobile phone. And you will often meet it in the form of investors and so on and so forth. I'm not sure if you've heard of some of the entrepreneurs that I'm going to talk about, but just to give you an example, I know two female entrepreneurs who actually raised their funding after going to 113 investors. Not 13, 113 investors, okay? And I'm sure there are similar stories of men out there. The reason for that is not that the ideas weren't good, but not every investor is going to buy your story. They are not going to be saying that you have an idea that could change the world. There are two ways to look at it. You learn from it and go back and say, do I really have an idea that solves a problem? Do I have an idea that somebody else is not doing as good as I am? As well as ask yourself, is this an idea that I think I can still go with? And I think at the end of the day, it's your own conviction that matters the most. If you are convinced of your idea, you will go places. And I don't think any startup dude or lady has said this. Actually, Mahatma Gandhi was the first man to say this. And so in many ways, the idea of entrepreneurship as we know it in India today might have started at several different levels in the last 200-year-old history, recent history as we've seen of industries emerging, people emerging, leaders emerging, and therefore building an ecosystem that could be pretty useful. Number three is that when I decided to leave journalism, which was just 2 years ago, let me actually put it this way, I decided to move away from mainstream journalism, okay, not journalism. And I said, okay, I'm done with primetime television, I've interviewed Warren Buffett, I've interviewed George Soros, have you guys heard these names before? Yeah. I've interviewed the finance minister, okay, who else do I want to interview? Right, Steve Ballmer when Microsoft was at its peak, okay, I'm done. Now who next, right? So one day I literally walked up to my editor and said, you know what, I don't want this job because it no longer attracts me. I don't think my viewers are necessarily on television. And plus I've interviewed everyone I wanted to. He was rather amused because people around me said, who leaves a prime time, 9 p.m. business anchoring job and says they want to be an entrepreneur? And then I went back to think about how my 15-year journey had been. Like I told you, I started with CNBC, which was back then a startup. Then I decided to join NDTV, which was still mulling the idea of whether they wanted to do a business channel. And then I went straight into the Times of India group with a brand new channel called the Economic Times Now. And every time that I joined a startup, I had fun, I grew, I learned, and I met new people. And at the point of my life, I stopped doing that. I said it was time to move on. And that's why I grappled with the idea that digital will make a big difference. 2012, I went to the United States to cover the elections when Obama was set to get re-elected. I just went because I was interested. I recorded myself on YouTube and uploaded it, and people watched. Shashi Tharoor came up to me and said, I don't mind giving an interview to a woman who's just putting up videos on YouTube. I'm perfectly fine with it. And I was so amazed at the ability of some of these people to see what digital can do to them, what it can do to reporting. Today, I say every person with a camera is a publisher. And the answer to that really is true. You can keep debating till the cows come home whether this is credible news, non-credible, but bottom line is each one of you today could become a publisher of information. And I think that is key to the way you plan your lives in the startup world in the future. What ideas you pick, which tools and toys that you want to sort of reinvent, whether you're going local, hyper-local, national, regional, what is the idea that you are chasing, how inclusive you are, how creative you are with what you want to share with everybody. I think some of these questions you have to constantly answer. One of the ways that I do it, I'm a big lover of post-its. You guys know what post-its are? Little yellow stick-ons, yeah? Every day I make a few of them and I stick them around. And I wonder if this is solving a problem. Is it helping my life? Is it actually taking Shethepeople to the next level? Actually, can I ask you to just slowly keep changing the slides? It would be just useful, yeah. And that's why when I first started Shethepeople out, I did not go looking for funding. A piece of advice that I can give you based on the number of kind of festivals I've been to in the last 10 days, everybody wants to know how to crack your first round of funding. That is not the answer to your startup. I believe TN Nainan was here sometime back talking about startups, and he talked about the doomsday scenario with 95% of them failing. At least that's what I heard from a professor outside. For whatever part that's true, I think it is driven by the fact that people are just dying to head out there to raise funds for their startup. And the minute they stop thinking of money, that's truly when they do well. I did not raise a single penny till the 15th month of my startup. I went out there with a plan to say, I will raise money because I want to do something with respect to seeing if I can sell my product. Can I get advertising? Can I get people to pay for my events? Can I get people to register? As a result, we went against the tide and said, we're not a free platform. You can watch us without paying money, but you have to register. 150,000 women are registered with Shethepeople today in the last 12 months. I finally went to raise funds and I went to the right guy. I didn't go to a woman. I mean, I could have. But I'm surprised to see how many men in this country support women entrepreneurs. And so Anand Mahindra put up his hand. He said, I am going to support you. And when I showed him my numbers, he said, but you don't really need money. I said, it's now that I need money because I have figured out a way to make money on my own. Please mark my words. That is a very important pillar of your startup journey. Can your startup make money on its own? That is a question you have to constantly answer. There are fewer and fewer people every single day willing to give their money for somebody to experiment. It's important to engage, it's important to inspire, it's important to empower the youth who have ideas, but it's also important to not be foolish, to be prudent, and truly put money where a real idea will emerge. So when you do go out there with your ideas, your startup plans, and your desire to do something new, please answer these questions for yourself. I increasingly feel a lot of the young startup owners reach there, set up a startup, and then start answering these questions, which is what contributes to those statistics that are showing that there is a large number of startups who are failing. And that is the reason they're failing. Please remember, when you go out there, you'll be asked these ugly questions by investors. May as well ask them yourself, so that you don't end up going to a place or being at a position where an investor has had to give you that yarn which you could have, you know, sort of found answers to on your own. Back to Shethepeople. We have now created, we are what, 18 months old, with Anand Mahindra as an investor now. We've had 35 events across the country. Earlier this year, some of you would have heard of an idea called Startup India. You heard it? This was Prime Minister Modi's vision. Shethepeople was one of the 5 partners to Startup India. We created the entire Women Entrepreneurial module led by Ms. Amitabh Kant. And along with that, we selected 10 women entrepreneurs who got an opportunity to meet the Prime Minister and tell the stories of what they've achieved, how they've done, what they've done. To me, the fact that today we have an ecosystem partly driven by the government and partly driven by really vibrant investors as well as entrepreneurs allowed a startup which was smaller than 1 year to go up there in Vigyan Bhavan, which is India's largest auditorium run by the government, stand out there with our logo and tell our story and actually engage with women entrepreneurs across the country and bring them out here in Delhi to meet the Prime Minister. To me, that is a big, big celebration of how the government views startups. I think there has been no better time than today for men and women to put their ideas forward and run with it. One of the things that people told me, and I think you could go back many, many years and you'll hear this from every single icon along the way, take risks, but take your risks smartly. There is no point taking a risk which involves you to just completely somersault your plan, your business, your savings, your life, and so on. I think make some measured decisions, get out there, and take a chance on yourself, and it can be totally transformational. I'd just like to add one bit, largely because I see a lot of men here. One of the things that Shethepeople has actually got accolades for is how inclusive we are in our conversation on women entrepreneurship, women achievement, women inspiration with men. From people like Rahul Bose, to Mr. Amitabh Kant, to Google's Rajan Anandan, to the current DIPP secretary, to the Prime Minister himself. We have done amazing, engaging conversations with men and why they need to support women in whatever journey they live. So for those of you looking for co-founders, don't get stuck just looking for another male co-founder. Go find a female co-founder. Maybe she has something she can add to your business or to your idea. As well as you build your businesses, I would really advise you guys to go out there and ensure that you are building inclusive businesses. You have a diversity that's not a diversity checkbox, but actually believes that other women are equal, will bring in new ideas, and actually add to what you're doing. I think if that starts at this age, this level of your entrepreneurial journey, it would be a game changer for you. I have two amazing men who work with me and help build Shethepeople. I have a team of 7 women journalists who do great stuff. But at the same time, I just feel if I didn't have, let's say, those 2 men in my team or 4 men, whenever they sort of double up or whatever, I would not have diversity of ideas. And that can totally change things. Why is the media business so, so amazing? Bursting with ideas, got new stuff happening. I mean, aside of the shouting every night, but lots of it that is actually so diverse and so exciting. It's because it is probably one of the rare industries in India today where the ratio men-women is closer to equal, if not equal. I would truly urge all of you to think about your entrepreneurial journey as a wholesome one, not one driven by valuations, because valuations alone will not take you places. And I literally would like to underscore that. Those of you who read pink papers, you already know what's happening to those who are in love with GMVs and valuations and what happens to their startups and how much under pressure they are to raise money so that they can live the next quarter. So please build sustainable businesses, smart businesses that are focusing on solutions so that you can truly fill a market gap and answer that for yourself. Don't wait till you have spent another 5 years of your life and then say, oh, now what do I do? This startup doesn't work, or somebody else has come up and done a better job. That's where I'd like to end it, and I'd like to take questions so that I can be effective in solving any issues that you might have. Any questions?
What's the meaning of the PMS? Just part of the Twitter
one. Okay, that's actually a brand that Twitter runs called Position of Strength, and it involves conversations on Twitter, a platform that we actively work with, not just use. To actually build conversations on why online women's safety is an important part of how women will get. That's our partnership effort with Twitter.
Coming to the mainstream business ideology, by everyday entrepreneurs like Iran Mazumdar Shah, maybe Sheldon Feinberg, any other person, what can be the difference between you and the mainstream female entrepreneurs, just not just focusing upon women entrepreneurship, but apart from the idea or the module of the business?
You mean what could be the difference?
Yeah.
Yeah, I suppose difference is always good. It adds diversity of conversation, but I think, I wouldn't say there's something different about Sheryl Sandberg, Kiran Mazumdar Shaw specifically. I mean, they just run different businesses. People have different scaling up in businesses, for example. So I suppose, Sheryl Sandberg at least had a career that rode the wave of what was happening in the rise of social media. But I think there is a great amount of wisdom with every layer of what business these women have been involved in. Look at Kiran Mazumdar Shaw, who has now probably been India's only self-built billionaire, if I go by the latest list. to have actually created something in a brand new industry, right? I mean, Biocon was a new age industry when she moved into it and she created that platform. I think there are two, three things to remember. One, what is the scale of your operation? Are you going to be the next Facebook? Are you really going to be the next Biocon? Is your business, which is digital or whatever, it has a certain scale that you want to achieve, which could, let's say in my case, it would be hypothetically 100 million, right? Somebody else would have a $1 billion business. I just think one has to look at different scales and steps. You can't sort of brush them with the same paintbrush simply because they just cater for different needs, right? If you look at any media platform in India, traditional media platform, they don't probably need more than 1,000 crores to survive even on mainstream television if they're doing really well. So I think every platform has a different scale to achieve. But I think it's more important to focus on what actually is the common thread among any entrepreneur who's a woman or a man, and it is common that works around with them. I think definitely one of them would be humility, otherwise none of these people would have reached where they have, or would come down and meet people and talk to them about their experiences. And I think number two is the fact that they took a chance on themselves. I mean, I can't tell you how important that is, how important that is. It is so easy to be in your comfort zone, and none of these women chose to do that.
Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am, for sharing your profound knowledge.
We're taking that question.
Okay, sure.
I want to start up something at this age. I don't have so much of money. Yeah. What is the best way of lending money at this age? Is it from bank? Is it from entrepreneurs like you? Ma'am, my father told he will not give so much of money. I have to 6 lakh for my startup. What is the best way of lending money?
I think first you need to figure out why you need so much money.
I want to start up something. I have some idea.
Sure, that's not fine. But I think what you need to say is that you have to divide your startup idea into phases. You have to work in phases. I personally don't recommend going to banks and taking loans. Definitely don't suggest that to students. But I do know that there are a few non-banking finance companies that are beginning to talk about student loans. Maybe worth asking them. Sure, you could do get to entrepreneurs, but again, I don't think that's a solution because a lot of it will depend on whether your idea works with that entrepreneur or not. A bit of an agnostic solution for you is to actually log on to the equivalent of a Kickstarter, put up your idea, let people take a chance on it, let people see, you actually get a good barometer measurement of your idea if you put it up on a public platform digitally that allows you to raise funds in the online space. And it'll also be a good way to judge whether your idea is selling with people before you, let's say, go to a bank, go to a seasoned investor or an entrepreneur. I think that would be a good start. Yeah? All right. Thank you. Thank you for listening.